Well, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming to my defense presentation, and thank you, Dr. Ji, for the introduction. And I would read you my title, but I'm going to go over it piece by piece in the next few slides. So just to go over the format, I have a lot of background and motivation, and then I'm going to go into the computational methods and go over one, what I call the baseline reference case in great detail. And then I have a list of about 12 trade studies that, time permitting, we can look at based on what you would like. So it's your choice. I have an incredible amount of data in there, and we're not going to be able to get through all of it. But when it comes time, I can go to the conclusion slides. So my timeline with RPI started in 2012, and I didn't have a nuclear engineering background at all. I was an aerospace engineer, and I had this idea of space reactors. I was going to go build something to go to Jupiter. As I started to learn more, I found out that's not a Ph.D. topic. You have to have something very specific, not build a space reactor for your Ph.D. topic. So I got into composite nuclear fuels because they're very high temperature, very good for space reactors. And as I learned more and more about them, I became more and more intrigued. And I ended up, in about February 2015, I met a researcher at LANL named Dr. Rao, who suggested an idea to me. And I ended up using that as my thesis topic based on what I'm going to talk about in the next few slides. So I'm going to go over each of these colored words in a little bit more detail, but enabling prompt temperature feedback using engineered heterogeneous composite matrix nuclear fuel. So, you know, the motivation is what is temperature feedback? Temperature feedback means your reactor, if it has a very large, what we call positive reactivity, meaning it's increasing in power very quickly, the power is going up. We want, as the temperature goes up, we want the reactor to decrease its increase in power. Basically, as the reactor gets hotter, we want the reactor to shut down. In some cases, you can have the opposite effect, where as it gets hotter, it would actually increase in reactivity. So these are criteria, but typically what we want is something like this green curve, where if we have some event where we get pushed, we want to have a very, what we call, over-damped response. Whereas we don't want something like this where we go up maybe really high in temperature and our reactor melts down before it comes in. So there's a lot of design parameters that go into designing reactors like this. And I'm going to actually show just a quick little video that I compiled from a few other YouTube videos for about a minute long, describing two very different responses to a very large reactivity insertion. So the first one is a reactor in Idaho called the SL1, and I'll apologize if everyone can't hear it, but I think you'll be able to hear it.
The centrifuge was lifted approximately 20 inches. This was 3 to 4 inches above its critical position of 16 to 17 inches. Approximately a 2% supercritical condition resulted, corresponding to a period of about 4 milliseconds. This supercritical configuration caused the rapid production of neutrons by fission for a total energy release of approximately 130 megawatt seconds. The fissions occurring within the fuel plates increased the temperature of these plates to a point near or above melting. The fuel within the plates experienced vaporization temperatures and burst the plate crack.
So that was the SL1 reactor in 1961. It had a very bad response. When the control rod was pulled, we added a lot of reactivity and it melted down and basically was a big accident. But I'm going to show you a different reactor. So that is known as a trigger reactor. It's a pulsed reactor. And in this same reactor, we're doing something very similar, where we're increasing the reactivity very quickly, but the reactor responds very differently. Instead of kind of, you know, it was a brilliant blue glow, but it wasn't a meltdown. It wasn't a catastrophic event. It was designed to handle this feedback in a way that it didn't melt down. So at the basis, that's what my thesis is about. How do we keep reactors in the events of these prompt supercritical events from melting down? So So again, as seen in the video with SL1, you know, you can have these prompt supercritical events. We measure reactivity in dollars for anyone who keeps wondering why I'm saying dollars all the time. But you can have an instance where your power is doubling on the order of milliseconds, meaning in a second it's too late, your reactor melts down. So human intervention, if I'm a reactor operator, I can't control the system. I have to have some kind of passive physical feedback in the system to really control this reactivity in a good way. And again, if that doesn't happen, here's the aftermath of the SL1 core. Here's Chernobyl, which is a very similar type of result where it blew the top off the reactor. There's actually a Soviet submarine that had a very similar accident. So these accidents have happened in the past, and they're a big issue. Now, a lot of different reactor types cope with this in different ways. Some of them use thermal expansion. Some of them, as we saw with the trigger reactor, they use a Maxwell-Boltzmann peak shift. So for both of those methods, you have to design your reactor correctly. They're very, very specific to the reactor. But there's a third one, Doppler feedback, which any reactor with U-238, it's a very strong resonance absorber. Any reactor with this, which is basically every commercial reactor because you don't have 100% enrichment, it has this negative feedback that as it heats up, there's these, what I'm going to get into is called resonances, that are going to absorb neutrons. And it's always going to be a negative feedback with U-238, and it's independent of your design. You can have a fast reactor, a thermal reactor, and we'll get into that. So give a nod to Dr. Dinone and his class, I'm going to put my neutron hat on here. So Dr. Dinone often says, put your neutron hat on, think like a neutron. So if you're a neutron and you fission U-235, you create more neutrons. So this is the chain reaction. And some of those neutrons go on to fission more and they create more neutrons. But before they do, they bounce around a little bit in the core. You can kind of see there's a few arrows there. Because when a neutron is born, it's born at a high energy and it slows down. Some of the neutrons, they leave. They get out of the reactor system and they leave. And they're a negative, like, addition that, you know, if you have a reactor leaving, it's a negative feedback. Now, some neutrons, this is what we're going to particularly look into, is some of them get captured. You'll notice it's still a uranium atom here, but it's uranium-238. And when this neutron gets captured, it doesn't create any more neutrons. So, you know, this is caused by what's called kind of a capture cross-section. And let me get a little bit into cross-sections are basically a measurement of what's the chance that this event is going to happen? What's the chance that a neutron is going to get absorbed in the fuel? And when a neutron is born, it's born at a very high energy. And it actually has a very low chance of getting absorbed. What it does is it bounces around in the energy and loses energy. And it usually fissions in this lower energy region. So in these middle areas, we have all these interesting peaks. And we call these resonances. And these are key to the Doppler feedback, and how they react to temperature specifically is what makes them work so well. So within the high energy region, if your fuel heats up, there's not much that happens. There's this what we call unresolved resonance region where you start to get a little bit of feedback from Doppler broadening. And then in this region where you have very large resonances that are very well defined and have a large peak value, you get a lot of cross-section change from that. And then in the thermal region, something that I found a little bit later in my work is there's actually quite a bit of S-alpha beta, which is kind of a measurement of the energy of a crystal lattice or kind of chemistry-type reactions that are happening with neutrons that have an energy on the order of those chemistry-type reactions. So that's actually a trade study, which I can get into, about how does S-alpha beta versus not S-alpha beta versus S-alpha beta on the fly work, but I can get into that
the
later.
The regions there are all messed up in your plot. In your writing and in your drawing, so the result resonance region in U-238 ends at 20 kV, like you show, and where you plotted high energy, it's actually, some of it is high and some of it is unresolved, which appears like a flat line.
Ah.
So all the stuff that has the big red is all resolved. So in the top, you wrote 200 kV. It actually starts at 20 kV. I don't know where it ends. I don't remember off the top of my head, but probably like 200 kV or something. So doesn't matter.
Okay, yeah.
Just next time you recycle this fixing.
Yeah, I'll say when we see the graphs, we'll find out this is the region that matters.
Yes.
And I'll make a case.
For thermal reactors, yes.
So, thinking a little bit more as a neutron, just to explain how does temperature change these Doppler peaks? And that's because in the previous picture, we saw very well-defined sharp peaks, right? In a lot of these, we have well-defined sharp peak, but as temperatures increase, the thermal vibrations of the atoms increase, which basically kind of creates a stochastic energy that what ends up happening is your resonance spreads out, it broadens, as we call it. And you know, if you're at a very low temperature, if your neutron is at exactly the right energy, it's like it won the lottery, it's going to get absorbed. But if you're at any other energy, you're going to escape the resonance very easily. Whereas statistically, if you broaden this resonance out and your neutron is passing through this region, it has a higher chance of getting absorbed. So it's through this mechanism of Doppler broadening that you get negative temperature feedback. So I'm going to take off my neutron hat for now, and we're going to talk about composite matrix fuels. Now, composite matrix fuels are just basically, this would be like a uranium fissile fuel kernel embedded in some kind of matrix, a continuous matrix, and you might make a fuel block out of it, you might make a core. Something to note is I'm calling this the microscale, the mesoscale is a fuel block, and the full scale, the full core. Now, a lot of people in the past have studied these kind of types of fuels, and they really like it, especially from the point of view of encapsulation, that this continuous matrix adds another barrier so that all those nasty products that happen after a fission occurs, they stay in the fuel. So a lot of people like it for that reason. They tend to like it for high burnup capability, for the thermal conductivity of matrix, even proliferation resistant, because it's a lot harder to reprocess the fuel if it's in this kind of matrix bound form. But I'm going to get into the reason why I want to study it and where there really hasn't been a lot of work done. And you'll see in a lot of codes, what they do is they actually homogenize. They take this red and blue heterogeneous area, and a lot of codes and treatment, they homogenize it and create a single area that's just a mixture. And I'm going to say, you know, that's very wrong. That in fact, this heterogeneity, even though it's very small, you can't just mix it together and get the same response out of your system. It causes a very different response. And now we get to the crux of what my thesis kind of explores is.
First, you clarify it's wrong. It's from what perspective it's wrong? From thermal, physics?
If from a lot of times, there's especially from the thermal point of view. The physics, they do a better treatment of it in a lot of cases, but from the thermal point of view, I'll get into, for example, there's a little bit of work by Professor Keist, where he's perhaps one of the few, the only people that's actually done a kind of a good treatment of a two-temperature model, where he treats the temperature of the center fuel kernel as different than the temperature of the matrix. But a lot of people have looked at, like you yourself have looked at the heterogeneity on the neutron transport. So now to get into this, you know, how does this prompt temperature feedback work? And it works in this fashion. Imagine that you have this fuel kernel and it's operating at normal power, and the center is a little bit warmer than the matrix, and then all of a sudden you insert maybe a large reactivity, and in that large reactivity you're going to create a lot of heating, and all that heating is just going to be in this center fuel kernel. So it's going to heat the center fuel kernel where the uranium is. And because it heats the center fuel kernel, that causes Doppler broadening and it decreases the reactivity of the system. So you get a very large negative Doppler feedback, and it's on the order of milliseconds, a very prompt feedback. And that's kind of the idea behind this thesis, is you, in the event of a prompt supercriticality accident, you have this effect, and the reactor shuts down before it would have any problems.
And the milliseconds is determined by what? By the neutronics or the heat transfer?
A lot of times by the neutron spectrum, and the prompt neutron lifetime is the biggest determination. Because you can have, with prompt neutron lifetimes in a fast reactor, like a 1 millisecond lifetime, where they can quickly double. Whereas with very thermal reactors, they can be, one microsecond. They can be hundreds of microseconds. So there's a very big dependence really upon the neutron spectrum.
The heat is immediate. That's not
the heat
of the times.
I mean, effectively, when the fission happens, it's some ridiculously small amount of time that it releases the heat. And it's like 10 to the negative 14 seconds that the fission actually occurs and releases heat. So as long as I'm not going into like, you know, picoseconds or something like that, you know, this is pretty well understood. It's instant temperature in that center spot. So yeah, I think I've talked with each of you and made the point across, but this is very key to understanding everything. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them right now. But if you understand it, I'll move to the next slide. So, you know, engineering, that's one of the last pieces of my title. How do we engineer the different material properties, the different geometric properties of this particle to improve prompt Doppler feedback? And that's going to be one of our you know, I have just a lot of case studies on this, and we'll look at this. So in terms of a literature review, what have other people done? And I'll say they haven't done a lot, because to model these in the past, let's say 20 years ago, you have a prompt supercritical reaction, you'd assume just a very simple exponential increase in power. And you'd say, well, you know, it's too complicated computationally to do the proper treatment, so we're just going to do maybe an exponential curve and try to figure out maybe a little bit about, there's a little bit of feedback in the moderator and then the temperature, maybe do a point kinetics model of some type. But really you did maybe a point reactor 20 years ago. But in order to really do this type of simulation where you have heterogeneity and things, you have to really understand that it's not a 0D point reactor, that you have to do the full 3D neutron transport, heat transport, or at least some approximation of, good approximation of that, to get a good result. And so it's really only been possible in the last 10 years. And for example, in the Monte Carlo codes, the temperature broadening that are needed, because in order to get these cross sections at different temperatures, you have to have the data for it, the nuclear data. And in the past, you had to generate just tons and tons and tons of cross-sections, but recently they've developed methods where you can do it on the fly. So you just have one cross-section set and you modify it. So a lot of the work on composite fuels has really been limited to more of the burn-up, encapsulation. You know, they're not really analyzing the short time scale effects in these other fuels. Now, what is comparable is there have been a few industry codes specifically that the industry knows that this effect happens. So when they were going to build, for example, the PBMR 400 from South Africa, there was a benchmark in there that they had 24 control rods, and they said, pull out all 24 in 100 milliseconds. It was a benchmark. So there were a few people that tried to tackle that, and one of them, my main comparable guys, Ortensi and then Stridum as well, did a little bit of work. But Ortensi is really the main guy. I'll get into his work on the next slide. There's also, I mentioned, a professor from Korea that did the two temperature models. His goal wasn't to model reactivity and insertion events. His goal was to model just a better temperature burnup profile for using TRISO particles and LWR fuels. So his scope was not in the prompt temperature feedback area. And then I mentioned Dr. Rao as well, that got me into this, and he wants to do actually an empirical test. He has a zirconium oxide surrogate fuel type experiment that he's performing, and he's just trying to see if the heat transfer methods, the analytical ones, match the experimental ones. So he's doing experimental work. He hasn't published anything yet. So that's
the treat reactor, I don't, is that relevant to this?
It is to a degree. I'll say that it was the way they approximated is they have this kind of half-life time that when they did tests on it, they measured kind of, they abstractly measured the thermal resistance and the effects of the delayed temperature. And they have that in several papers where they kind of model it as an exponential kind of time, that in the beginning there's no release and there's more later, but it's all been empirical. It wasn't really modeled. It was, let's pulse it and see what happens and record all the data. And okay, this is what the constant is. So mine's more in detail.
So you could model it?
Yeah. Now, I won't say I can do a full core simulation. My stuff I'll talk about is limited to kind of infinite lattice cells. And also the treat reactor had more to do with the graphite temperature feedback than the Doppler, because the fuel particles in treat were so small, they had no thermal resistance. They basically released their heat instantly.
But this reactor is revived, and there will be some experiments, so this is relevant.
Mm-hmm.
So Wei Ji would probably want to capitalize on that.
Yeah.
It's the way forward. That's why I'm asking.
Yeah. I really like the FEM fuels. And I can talk about it. I'm actually going to be working for a company that's doing, it's silicon carbide particle fuels. So I'm hopefully going to be able to directly translate the skills that I've learned here to that job in the future. So just to go over what Hortensi did, Hortensi had a RZ diffusion code called Synop that they had built for this pebble bed reactor. They also had relap and this other code that did heat transfer. And he added this intermediate level that added the kind of the multi-scale, which I'll talk more about when I talk about my multi-scale method. But he added kind of this small fuel particle simulation where you do a spherical heat transfer. And he would get these graphs and curves. And I'm actually going to have a little bit later one of my slides that compares one of my cases to one of his cases. So I can show that I'm very, not exact, but I'm very similar to a lot of the things that he got. So again, another big limitation that I'd like to point out is really diffusion-based solver limitations. So Hortensi did the correct thermal treatment. He did a full core analysis, which is very impressive as well. But another limitation of Hortensi is that he was doing this during NGNP, and after NGNP ended in about 2009, he published it as a journal paper, and then he just didn't do anything with it. So there's not really active research in this area that's being completed by anyone except maybe Lee, who I mentioned was a Korean guy, but he's not really looking at it from the same angle that I am. So I'll get a little bit into determinism versus Monte Carlo and why this problem is a really good problem to do for Monte Carlo. And Monte Carlo is good because it's kind of like a Swiss army knife, that you can use it in all kinds of applications. And its problem, though, is that it has a lot of uncertainty. It's very time-consuming, computationally difficult to solve these problems with a high enough detail, whereas deterministic codes are very quick, but they require a lot of setup. You have to have the right cross-sections. You have to make sure you discretize everything properly. So let me get specifically into that with cross-sections, which is, as I mentioned, cross-sections are a key point in the study. If I have a prompt temperature feedback and my cross-sections are changing very quickly, how do I know that my diffusion code, if I use the diffusion code or some other type of deterministic code, is properly treating that temperature rise? So really what you'd like is a Monte Carlo code as a baseline, and then to take maybe a deterministic code and compare it, and if they're good, then you use the deterministic code because it's faster. But to generate these cross-sections for Monte Carlo, this is the nuclear data. You pull in the raw nuclear data. You do kind of this some fitting functions that are fairly simple to do on the fly. And then you do your material weighting cross, and then you get your macroscopic cross-section. Whereas deterministic, what you have to think about is, okay, I've broken up the energy grid and the spatial grid, and I have an incredibly fine mesh, and then I collapse it. I make a more of a coarse, should be an A there, a coarse mesh. And then when I get to the end, I'm like, did I do it right? Does it all look proper? Did I scale it right? And then not only do you have to do it once, but then you say, okay, let's do it for a different temperature. Let's do it for a different burnup. Let's do it for a whatever. You have to generate a lot of cross-section data for your, you have to treat it properly, basically. So you have to think about it, whereas Monte Carlo, I chose Monte Carlo for my work because it's something that I can use, and it also has continuous energy, which gives me an incredible ability to analyze these problems. So now we finally get to my goal. What am I contributing? And really what I'm contributing is I want to show clear evidence of this prompt Doppler feedback effect, prompt temperature feedback effect in these composite fuels. So I want to quantify the response in terms of reactivity, time scales, temperatures, things like that. You know, what does it look like? How much feedback can I get out of the system? And ultimately determine what are the key parameters. And then, you know, I can't really say that I'm optimizing, but I can propose new, improved designs. Not optimizing takes a lot of computational power that I don't have, but I can kind of take what I learned from a lot of parametric studies and propose, well, this one's probably a little bit better. So again, my methods, key to this are the on-the-fly treatments for the Doppler and the S. I found out later that S alpha beta does have a moderate effect on it, so I'm now taking that into account, especially on the graphite.
And it's free to take.
Yeah, I got Andrew's stuff, so
yeah,
that's great. And then I'll get into my parametric stuff. So again, I have a lot of parametric studies and the parameter variations, and I can get into that in the future. But let me talk about the computational methods. So I mostly was in this area. I was doing 1D infinite lattice unit cells of fuel particles, you know. And this was most of my research. I have one trade study that just kind of takes a look at the fuel block form, where I have a fuel block of certain dimensions. And I try to ask the question, does having a, for example, the temperature changes over this radius, does having a variable temperature and having kind of a larger scale, does that really change the problem very much? And the conclusion of that trade study was, at least for that particular fuel block, the answer was no. But I can go into that trade study in the future.
So I have a question about your, so you're going to continue with number one, right?
Mm-hmm. For the most part.
Yeah, so I think this is easily extendable to even a 3D cell that has a fuel pin and moderator and leading, right? Which
yeah.
is more applicable to most reactors than, this is a specific type of reactor that we don't have yet, really.
Yeah.
So why did you choose that and you never looked at the fuel pin?
So it is similar to the TRISO-like fuels. And that's, there are people looking at TRISO fuels and a fuel pin. It doesn't give you the right answer because it's neutronics is sensitive to realistic geometry, whereas conduction is really not sensitive.
So in neutronics you have the unit cell on the top with a reflective boundary condition.
Yes.
And for thermal hydraulics you actually use this equivalent cylindrical.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is now cylindrical.
Well, you, equivalent sphere.
Yeah. Spherical.
Yeah,
sorry.
Right. So
that's only valid as long as you have a given thermal conductivity ratio and thermal resistance ratio.
Yeah, if the thermal resistance of this outer matrix was
should
very,
be far lower.
Yeah. Now, a while back I talked to Doc, I asked the question to my advisor, do you want me to do a 3D moose model of the heat transport, or would you rather see a fuel block simulation? And he was, Dr. G was saying, how about a fuel block rather than a moose model? Because we really don't expect anything interesting to happen when we would model this in 3D.
For heat transport.
Yeah, because I could do 3D heat transport using moose, and this using just so moose is a finite element code that can solve conduction problems very easily. So. I could couple this to any, you know, finite element code that would do thermal problems. But in my opinion, it really, as long as you have a high thermal conductivity in your matrix, it's not going to change your answer very much. And as I'll show later, in the beginning of the transient, all the interesting things are happening here, right in the center. So it's only going to be at the very end of the transient that your heat will come out of the matrix and really start to affect what your problem would be. So it's kind of, for the beginning of the transient, we're fine. Maybe at the very end of the transient, you'd have to ask a few questions.
But are you translating your neutron flux as a function of position to a heat source, which is R-dependent?
Yeah, it's...
So you have a problem with cosines translating to Bessel function or whatever, or you keep the cosines instead of Bessel function, I don't know.
So when you get to the region that's still within the cube, you're fine because it's spherical is spherical. But when you get to these outer edges, you make an equivalent volume sphere to your cube and you solve basically.
What's the profile of the heat that you put into the
spheric up model?
It's a 1D, it's 1D radial, so I can have different... So
can you use a cosine from the neutronics, or...?
I take fission tablets. So it's
where? In the square set? I have to translate yeah. to a spherical set.
Well, I don't really have to translate it if this in the center, the sphere is equal to the sphere, right? There's no change in geometry between this and this, right? And that's
right.
where all the fissions are happening.
So there. But in the top calculations, you have cosine distributions for x, because and if you were neutronics doing it in a spherical, have Bessel functions, but they're probably looking almost the same.
Yeah, they're
gonna not by Bessel. You have sine over r, which
yeah.
is a weirder function.
You're very correct, but the one thing is that the thermal conductivity of this matrix makes it almost the same temperature. It makes it almost
okay. So there's something there, but
it's very small. It's an effect, but it's a small effect.
So in this heat transport, how do you take into account this condition between these two regions?
So it's a finite difference model with about 200 mesh points, and it's just when you get to the outermost mesh and the outermost mesh, you go ahead and you take the temperature change from the outer surface of the inner part as the boundary condition there. So as long as your mesh is fine enough, you're not going to have any problems where you have to worry about overlapping regions. And then the mesh is also connected, like there's a certain number of points that are only within the matrix, and then there's a boundary point, and there's a certain number of points that are only within the kernel. So it's just that one boundary point, you're assuming that the temperature, the delta T, you're assuming that this guy here, the change in temperature is just like, if you think about it, if you take an infinitely thin slice of one region, so, and you put it next to another region, it's going to be the same temperature as the other region as long as it's infinitely thin. So as long as the mesh is sufficiently small, I can have I can do that condition between the two regions where you just take the temperatures just as if they were any other points.
But you're assuming there's no contact resistance, but it's ideal.
Yes, yes. Now, when I get a little bit, when I talk about, I have a lot of the physics for the fuel block, so I'm going to go a little bit into the fuel block. Again, I didn't do a lot of simulations with the fuel block, but I have one if you want to see it. And in this one, there's a coupling between the microscale and the mesoscale, and that coupling happens at the outermost part of the kernel. So you have the temperature of the fuel at its outermost radius that's informing the mesoscale heat transfer. And in this one, I also approximated this. So this would be a fuel block. And I made the same approximation where I said the fuel block can be approximated as a 1D cylinder. Right? This hexagon is pretty close to this guy here. And within, sure, you have temperature distributions here within each particle. But as a bulk material, as a continuous matrix material, you can make the same argument for why a cylinder would match the hexagon type shape. And then what you're doing is you have this multi-scale informed model where you take each cell within the cylinder and you assign a representative microscale model. And within this microscale model, you do 1D spherical heat transport. And you only really do the heat transport to the surface of the particle because that's the interface into the matrix. So again, I was talking about, within the fuel blocks, it's an infinite fuel block lattice. So I'm still not really doing a real core with leakage. I'm just doing what happens when you have a channel there, and what happens when you have, there's going to be a temperature distribution over this. It's going to be hotter at the edges and a little bit cooler on the inside. So again, this is something that, in the future, it could be coupled to something like Moose or a 3D, finite element or solver, but it doesn't really need to be to get the effects, and I make the same argument as I did before.
I don't get something here. So when you do this, you
you have a lot of kernels in there, the yellow stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you individually simulate them or you homogenize them?
So I take each region here, so each individual cell. So you break this cylinder in a bunch of different cells, and you assign a mic. Let's see if I have a good. Here we are. You assign a micro scale particle for each cell, and you're going to be solving heat transfer in the cell.
So each shell is one sphere, micro sphere.
Each shell is a continuous matrix, but it also has a model for a particle. So each shell is modeled as a solid material, but then within each solid material you have, for example, here's the terms here. You have your conduction in the matrix, you have your change in energy of the matrix, and this is basically a heat source. You're basically solving the conduction equation with a heat source. In a lot of other ways, you would call this Q triple prime. But in here, all the heat is being produced in the kernel and it's leaking out into the matrix. So you have this term here that couples the micro scale and the macro scale heat transfer. And again, you have, you know, one, like this would be for region 7, you have one micro scale representative region that informs this part of the equation for the mesoscale.
So really your result will depend on how your annular cells are relative to the size of your micro-particle. Because my numerical answers are dependent on.
So it's gonna, the size of the particle is gonna be, if the particles, you're talking about how much you discretize this area?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, so if we break it into, we could actually break this into quite a number, like in reality, I could break this into an infinite number of cells, even if it's smaller than the fuel kernel. Because you kind of have this idea of a continuous distribution of, you know, there's some representative fuel particle for any region, any mesoscale radio coordinate R. But I have to discretize it because it's a finite difference code, so I only have a certain number of cells.
You will come to the energy balance, but the time scales you are looking for the Doppler feedback now are a function of what you're doing.
So I do solve the conduction equations on like a nanosecond time scale, and then they're coupled with the heterogeneous particles. So yeah, you have to think about your methods. I mean, if your time step's too messed up.
Did it trace study on the number of cells you chose?
So there was really, since heterogeneous neutron transport in these cells is pretty intense, I ran into computational difficulties where I couldn't run a lot of trace studies on them. I only really have one block, fuel block case because of that. And I broke it into 10 regions, and I could, if you'd like, have till August, I can do more. I can break down 20 or 30, see if there's any change.
You want to be sure that your conclusions on the Doppler are not function of your numerical schemes.
Yeah.
Can you explain the some phi, phi, phi m, sp, and p?
Yeah, so this is the matrix volume fraction. And then this is the standard rho Cp dt. So this is your change in energy. And you have this matrix volume fraction that couples these two terms. And this really comes from the Vogel paper that it was a master's thesis someone published on the topic of doing exactly what I'm doing, this kind of multi-scale.
What is Sp?
Sp is the surface area of each particle, and that's a number of particles per unit volume. So this is basically just a representative area, how much area per unit volume particle do you have? And then here's the change in temperature. Here's the dt between the outer part of the matrix and the particle. And then you have this interesting term here I do have to worry about a surface conductance here because the matrix is now homogenized, right? The fuel particle has a finite element grid, but this is each cell, it's a constant temperature. So I actually do, I can get into how exactly I solve for surface resistance, but it basically has to do with finding what the, you know, the thermal conductivity divided by, you know, you have to find what this average matrix temperature radius is. And if you take the steady state equations and you solve for where is the radial position of the average temperature of the matrix, you get that this is the correct form. And it's still kind of an approximation because during a transient you can have all kinds of interesting things happening. But it should be about the best approximation you can get without doing a full model where you discretize everything and do really small heat transport. So
we'll go back to the equation. So in this equation, which is anode, which is node?
Sorry, what?
Which is anode?
The anode?
Yeah, the anode.
The unknown. We're trying to solve for the change in temperature for change in time. We can get this is a
matrix, right?
Yeah, in the matrix.
What is the TP? Is it known or unknown?
So TP is the temperature of the particle cell. That's a known. So this is a known, this is a known as well, because both of these are from the current time step.
But the TM is unknown.
The TM is known because you're using a backwards difference model. So you use the last temperature. So there's a current temperature of the matrix and a current temperature of the particle. You're trying to solve for the change for the next time step. Of the simulation.
This equation is the key for when you go to the so-called Maslow scale. So mm-hmm. If you give us a explanation, make sure you understand and we understand.
Go back
to the equation.
If I solve for it explicitly, it'll look something very similar to this.
No, I'm talking about the physical model. I'm not talking about the numerical, how you do the computation. That's minor, that's mm-hmm. nothing. And physics model here. So when you use this equation and give us some, your understanding is what the physical scenario here talk about. Do we see there all the particles in each annular region?
So
at this point?
I'll put it this way. Let's say we take this term out. We take mm-hmm. it out. This would be heat transfer in a block of Swiss cheese. Right? There's a certain amount of matrix volume. So these two terms solve heat transfer in a block of, let's say, Swiss cheese, where you take out all of the fuel particles. Then this term is basically a heat source. You're getting the heat source from your particle. You know, you have these other microscale models where you have a certain temperature distribution. And you are finding the change in temperature of the matrix to the outer surface of that particle, and you have this basic condition, but in effect, this is just a heat source to a standard conduction equation. So
the heat source is what is coming out to the boundary of each of the particles.
Exactly.
And you just assume there are n particles, a certain number of particles. You don't consider where they are, that's the distribution. There's some heterogeneity that is not taken into account.
Yeah. Stochastically, there's going to probably be some effects. There's going to be some that are closer, some that are further. But I'm assuming there's an even distribution. As long as in most of my case studies, I looked at a thermal reactor, which has a very large spacing between particles. And as long as there's a large spacing between particles, it's a very accurate. And the Vogel paper has a very much in detail on how the method works, and I could go into greater detail.
Symmetry helps you here.
Yeah.
Because everywhere it's the same.
Yeah.
Okay, I get it.
So as far as initial conditions, the first thing you solve for is what's your initial temperature distribution? And the way you can solve that is, it looks a little complicated, but it's just you start with a certain power and an assumed power distribution. You solve for a steady state temperature distribution, and then you run a Monte Carlo code to get a different power distribution, and you compare your assumed power distribution to your Monte Carlo one, and if it's different, then you have to update the location of where the power is being generated, and you do another simulation. But eventually, your assumed power source matches your the current power source. And it's pretty easy to solve the steady state conduction. I actually analytically can solve for those very easily in a sphere and in a cylinder as well. This would be getting the initial temperatures. And then the transient initiation. Think of this, you think of K infinity multiplied by something. You think of the four-factor formula, right? K infinity multiplied by the leakage, resonance escape, the fast fission, all of those things. Well, this is basically how I'm starting the transient, is I basically am just saying, imagine I arbitrarily change the probability of leakage a little bit. Well, that's the same thing as creating this virtual eigenvalue multiplier, right? So instead of, in a realistic simulation, I'd have to pull a control rod or change the concentration of boron in the water or something like that. But in this case, I'm doing it virtually, and it's also similar to practices that are used in a lot of papers that I've seen where they arbitrarily increase, say, the fission cross-section by a factor of 10 to start their transient or something like that.
It is true, but you have to remember that some variables are common to gamma and T for some perturbations. For example, if you change absorption, it goes, well, it might be together. There's some absorption in the leakage, so if it's linear, then it's not a problem.
Yeah.
So you would change this absorption in gamma and in K infinity. Mm-hmm. I think it's linear, so you're off the hook.
For small reactor, it changes.
Yeah.
Large.
But now my other confusion is you're back to talk about one, not the block, just one sphere, right? You're going to the fundamentals of
ice. So if you'll look in my next slide, I'll get into how that all works together. So how does this K-effective affect the large scale model? And what you do is I actually made this just for you, Dr. Genome, because you'd asked for a flowchart. You do a Monte Carlo simulation, and from that simulation, you get a value of your raw K infinity, and you get a value for your prop neutron lifetime, your beta effective, and then also you have to take a fission tally, so you know where the heat is being generated. And once you know those things, you get into this loop where you solve for your reactivity, and then you solve your kinetics equations. And that gives you your power, and your power density comes from using the fission, the fission tally and how much power you have, and then you solve your conduction equations, and you find your change in temperature, and then you have this criteria here that you don't want to do a Monte Carlo simulation every time step. You only want to do it every so many time steps. You want to say, well, the Monte Carlo only needs to be redone if the temperature changes by a certain amount, because as we said, it's the cross-section changes with temperature. That's what's really changing in the simulation. So we have a criteria here. And what it comes down to is that...
Can you clarify, let's see. Time step.
Mm-hmm.
There are a couple transient processes here.
Mm-hmm.
The heat conduction, the power, change.
Mm-hmm.
And so a couple of time dependent equations, so which time step we prefer.
So for these guys, for the reactivity, for the kinetics equations and for the conduction equations, you really have to do it on a nanosecond time scale. You have to do it very quickly because you want an accurate approximation. You want an accurate understanding of how the temperature is changing and how the power is changing. When you get to the Monte Carlo, that's more of, in generally, a millisecond time scale, because it takes some amount of time for enough energy to build up to change the temperature of the fuel. So there's kind of this nano to millisecond like time frame. So when I come down to it, it's one
second. Here you have the solved kinetics plot. Do you use point kinetics for that?
Yeah, point kinetics, that's part of the flux factorization method.
So initially you keep point kinetics, but you're actually using it.
I'm using it as a...
Your introduction.
It's a flux factorization method, right? It makes it to where you can use a K eigenvalue code and the kinetics equations and get a pretty darn good accurate answer for what's happening with the neutronics transient. So that was proposed back in the 1960s. They did a lot of work in the quasi-static, approved quasi-static, the flux factorization methods. But it's only been very recently that it's actually even, computers have gotten even good enough to use that approximation. And very recently, there's actually been a lot of dynamic Monte Carlo papers that's going to be the next step, that you're not even going to worry about doing a K eigenvalue code. You're just going to do a source propagation. But that's even more computationally challenging than doing a K eigenvalue. So by using this methodology, it makes it to where you get a very good answer and you do a K eigen code rather than having to do a source code. And then you these thermal and kinetics equations are trivial to solve compared to the Monte Carlo takes well over 99% of the computer time to get an accurate Monte Carlo answer, whereas these other equations, even though they're being solved every several nanoseconds, they come out very quickly. So
it's why they do this with codes that are like discrete ordinates. Mm-hmm. So for like Pentran codes that were designed for maybe weapons, because they need to do it fast and comfortably.
Yeah. So in 10, 20 years, someone's going to be like, Morrison's methods were completely out of date. Now we can use dynamic Monte Carlo.
Monte Carlo will get faster, so your problem here will be the main issue.
All right.
So I still want you to clarify that.
The time steps?
The power change. Mm-hmm. You have a time step.
So the power change is going to be...
Let me finish first. So you have a power change. And you have our spatial, let's say, the spectrum change. That's also time-dependent. Mm-hmm. Power change is time-dependent because you mentioned flux factorization. Mm-hmm. You separate your power with your spatial and the energy distribution. Mm-hmm. So both time-dependent. And also you have a heat conduction. Mm-hmm. Also you have time-dependent heat conduction. So, do you use the same time step for all these three?
No, it's, I have, so...
From that flow chart, I can't see this relationship.
So for the time step for these guys, it is a fixed, I do have a fixed time step that I set very small. It's on the order of 10 nanoseconds, which you can look at the prompt neutron lifetime, and that kind of gives you an idea of how fast power will change in the reactor. So as long as your time step is significantly shorter than the prompt neutron lifetime, then I'll make the case that my time step is small enough to capture the intricacies of how the reactivity, the kinetics equations is changing the power, which is changing the temperatures. I can do that pretty well as long as I have this, much shorter time step. And the fission, or the spectrum, for example, and the K eigenvalue, those are changing with temperature. So those happen, you only have to run that every, the criteria isn't actually a time criteria. I say milliseconds here, but it's a temperature criteria. Say if the change in temperature since the last Monte Carlo, if there's been enough of a change in temperature. So the last Monte Carlo, if it was, let's say you inserted just 1 cent of reactivity, maybe you don't have, maybe you don't have to do a Monte Carlo for 60 seconds, right? But if you insert a dollar worth of reactivity, you have to do it within a few milliseconds. So if there's not a fixed time scale for the neutronics or for the Monte Carlo aspects, it's a temperature criteria. And again, like you were saying, if I make my time step here too large, then it's not checking this criteria enough and it won't do the Monte Carlo on a soon enough time
step.
So
what was your criteria?
So this was computationally resource dependent, and I can talk about how it was a factor of O of T squared is you take smaller, let's say you go
from... More or less, how many degrees was that?
Five. 5 degrees.
So within 5 degrees, you're actually changing the flux based on point kinetics, ignoring the Doppler broadening, and then every 5 degrees, you're updating with a more accurate calculation. You're bringing it back to a sort of reality,
exactly.
Just the Monte Carlo.
Yeah.
That's the bigger picture.
Yeah.
I have one question which I forgot, so it's not important. The 10 nanosecond is a shake in MCMP, so you probably chose like the ancient people choose.
Yeah.
You can't do a fraction of shake.
Yeah, but shake means something.
Two shakes of a lambstown, right?
Yeah, no. Shake in MCMP means something, but it's related.
It's got some weird units.
It's related to weapons.
Yeah. So,
which have fast transients.
Yeah. So, in the interest of time, I'll go quickly through some of these other parts. But I have a material library, realistic material library of quite a number of different materials. I did the best validation that I could, looking at things like, do I get the same eigenvalue in Serpent that I do at MCMP? Is my kinetics, I have a C++ kinetics code and a MATLAB code. For the same inputs, do they give me the same outputs? And then really one of the big ones that I want to specifically point out is this is Ortensi's work. This is from one of his transients. And this is from my model of one of his transients. There were a few parameters he didn't specify that I had to play with a little bit. So this isn't exactly a quantitative, I matched him exactly. It's more of a, look, I have the same behavior in my, I took his power distribution and fed it into my thermal model, and I get pretty similar results to his for the same size of particle, for the same initial power, for the same power spike.
So again, why is yours better, or what is different than Ortensi?
So as far as my thermal model, they're very similar. They're very similar methods. It's really in my neutronics and also my focus. My focus is on looking at the underlying physics, where his focus was just getting a little bit better values for the PBMR 400. So mine's much more fundamental, and using the Monte Carlo, as you'll see in the next.
So if somebody wants to use the two methods, why would he choose your method?
They would choose mine because it's more adaptable. His was really focused on the PBMR code, or PBMR reactor. So if you wanted to look at a different kind of reactor, a different fuel configuration, or if you had just something different. And the other thing is his code is kind of stuck behind a curtain of, you know, this is INL's, it wasn't quite proprietary, it wasn't INL code, but I can't just go download it. I can't get, one of the difficulties in just, how do I model and look at this? Because what I want to do is I want to look at parameter variation. And all he wanted to do was look at one benchmark, right?
So for a full core.
For a full core, yes. So I'm looking at it, I'm at the same point, but I'm looking in a different direction, is what I would say.
So your comparison with him that you just showed, was mm-hmm. that for a block calculation, or
it's a spherical particle. So this is...
So
this
he
is,
did the same? He did the
same? He did the same thing, spherical mm-hmm. particle.
But then he generalizes it to the whole core.
He doesn't actually talk a whole lot about how he does that. His papers were only focused really on just this. On just his 1D model, and he says I coupled it into the part of the relap code that, you know, does the whatever. So you can't really see behind the scenes what's going on, and unfortunately, there's not like, I mean, he's no one. You know, he was publishing his stuff, but whoever was publishing the stuff about everything else that was done, they didn't publish anything. So I can't really get a good understanding of every. Aspect.
That's the best set you found to compare your code to?
This is as far as this for the temperature model, yes. It's a pretty good model. Again, there's other things that I can do, like I did steady state comparisons, and I just did some, like, well, if we have an increase in power of this much, how much should the temperature change based on rho Cp? You know, and that seemed to match. So. Another step of validation would really be to go to 3D Moose transport and see if I get the same answer, right? But the fact that I...
So Moose can do that?
Moose can do, it's basically a 3D finite element solver, so I could actually even started to work on it. I have a mesh code where I can make these meshes that are really nice for this problem, but I chose to focus on the fuel block instead. But yeah, you could take it and do it 3D, but I would make the case that as long as my model's correct, you won't really see much difference. It'll just be prettier pictures, basically, because you'll get like a 3D picture rather than some of the pictures that I'll show you shortly.
Well, the reason for this question is, first I'm trying to understand what's the advantage of your model, and how does that tie into the motivation to do all this work? So if there's another better method to do it, why do you bother? Second, you've done this already, right? So how good is it? How do I benchmark and know that I can trust it? And third, if there's a more advanced code, can this be used to actually benchmark that code, or vice versa?
I'll say that...
So you understand this, we talked about it before, that kind of validation really, and looking at what else is done is important.
As I mentioned, it's really those industry codes are the only ones that have really looked at this, and they don't publish much, right? Like, I can't get these codes to really compare my results against, and my goal again, you know, I'm really looking at the underlying physics and the ability to improve the effect. And in order to do that, I have to be able to run many studies, many cases, and look at different parameters. Or if you look at Ortensi's paper, he just ran like one case for that one benchmark. And you know, at the end of the day, I'm looking to just understand what's going on. He was looking at just the model a little bit more accurately what was going on. So I'll make the case, you know, my novel contribution is a much better, and I'll say because of my Monte Carlo that I'll get into, I'll be able to show you exactly why it's better than the diffusion code that he used. So as far as thermal models goes, his is the same as mine. But as far as neutronics models, I think mine gives a much better understanding.
Now let's go back to physics. So I don't know if you can keep this plot.
Or this one?
The one you just had, the comparison.
Oh.
If I don't know if you're going to talk about it, just fair. But I'm interested to understand what determines the time for peaking and the maximum temperature in your code. If you're going to talk about it later, let's leave it.
Yeah, let's talk about it later.
Okay.
So I'll breeze through this again. Conceptual fuel design, this is what I was saying about. How do we engineer an improved Doppler effect? And we have, one of the big things is selecting the proper thermal resistance. So as far as thermal resistance goes, I mentioned this, you know, in the matrix, you want a very small thermal resistance. So you can see there's not a lot of temperature change in the matrix. But then in the coating, we want there to be a lot of thermal resistance. That way we can keep the heat contained in the matrix. And to a large extent, we want to really have a good thermal conductivity to a degree in the fuel, because we don't want a lot of peaking. So this one has a lot of Doppler, has a lot of resistivity, but it also, if you think about it as, this one has more uranium at higher temperatures than this one does, even though they both have the same temperature peak. So there's a lot of thermal criteria when you look at thermal resistivity, and I have trade studies on that I can show you later. And as far as neutronic parameters go, you know, you got a U-238 is probably the best, and I'm going to make a case for that, but there are actually a lot of other resonant absorbers that are out there, and I have a trade study looking specifically at tungsten to see how does having tungsten as a coating change the behavior of the fuel. But, you know, some of these criteria, like This is the uranium 238 in blue. Look at this peak. Huge. It's one of the tallest peaks with one of the smallest bases. When you compare it to like hafnium,
it's the 4-volt resonance.
Yeah. It's. I looked at.
It's not 4. It's like 8.
Well, this is pulled from Janus. So you can see a lot of these, and if you look at, like, for example, hafnium has one of the highest peaks that I could find. I pulled up a code and I looked at every kind of absorber I could think of, and none of them had as good of a base to peak as a U-238.
How about U-235 itself? Does it do anything? Say we have
a
reactor that is 93% enriched.
Well, the problem there is your fission cross-section is the problem too, so your fission increases at the same rate your Doppler increases.
Yeah.
And I have a trade study on that too, showing how if you have 100% enrichment,
yes,
you get almost no feedback. It just, your core burns out. So with that, I'm going to get into really exciting stuff, and hopefully that'll get a little more interesting for everyone in the audience. So what I really want to show here in this case study, this is my in-depth case study, but is that I have a homogeneous model where I took this whole thing, I combined it together, I homogenized it, and I'm comparing it to my heterogeneous model. These are also all of the parameters in the study that, you know, all the levers and knobs that I can turn. So if you look at this whole screen, these are all the parameters that define a problem. And some of them are operational, such as how much reactivity do I insert? And some of them are material, like what kind of materials am I using? So there's a lot of different parameters and knobs and levers to turn. And in a lot of my trade studies, I try to do that. But in this one, all I'm trying to do is establish what's the difference between heterogeneous and homogeneous. So there's a lot of interesting things. This is what I call, you'll see these a lot in my studies, what's the worth if I take, this is taking the whole cell, if I take the whole cell and set it to a certain temperature, and I take the reactivity change, you'll see that actually in the homogeneous field you get more feedback, more Doppler feedback. And that might sound a little weird, but I can explain it. Neutrons, when you have a heterogeneous region, imagine a neutron is bouncing around in the moderator region. If it bounces around in the moderator region for a long enough time, it's going to thermalize before it gets back into the fuel and can get absorbed. So because of this heterogeneity, you actually have a little bit less total worth in homogeneous cases, because in heterogeneous cases, the neutron can bounce around in the moderator. So that makes sense. And then this is just looking at, if I just take, this is just the heterogeneous case. You can actually see that most of the worth, we see about $17.50 of worth going from 300 to 3000 Kelvin. Most of the worth is in the fuel. So this is a Doppler worth, but there's actually, this is a lot of the kind of S alpha beta and also the thermal vibration type cross sections. They're actually causing a slightly negative, but as far as things go, it's the Doppler feedback in the center of the fuel particle that's causing the feedback. And this is where I keep, for example, in the moderator work study, I keep the fuel at 300 Kelvin, but I increase the temperature of just the moderator. Then the fuel worth one, I keep the moderator at 300 Kelvin, but I increase just the fuel. And this is where I increase both temperature and moderator. It's the same graph as what I showed before.
In the moderator, you're taking the density changes as well, or here there's no density changes?
So one of my shortcomings, limitations, is I do not have a thermal expansion model in here. I've kept everything at constant density throughout here. And that's actually a pretty key factor. But in order to add that in, there's a lot of extra physics. And it's something that I would suggest if someone wanted to do another like add-on to this for perhaps another PhD topic, that would be an excellent one.
But your moderator is graphite?
It's graphite, yes.
So probably, I don't know how much density changes over that range, but maybe it's not a big effect. Between, you know, room temperature and 3000, do you know how much density of graphite changes?
I have that value in one of my previous graphs.
That's better.
Ways back.
It's not big,
but it's not terribly important, but in terms of density, graphite, it's
awesome. Changing very little, yeah.
So, let's get back to my... So now we get to the really prepare, well, okay, here's the initial solution. So one of the big differences between heterogeneous and the homogeneous is that you have this temperature peaking that's happening. So that heterogeneous fuel actually starts at a higher temperature. And that's kind of a negative against it, because you're losing out on all this Doppler. If your whole fuel was at a low temperature and it increased this much, you would get more Doppler out of it. But because it's already at a higher temperature, so there's actually less Doppler because it's at a higher peaking point. And if you're too close to the melting temperature of the fuel, for example, you can't get any Doppler, because if you increase in temperature, you're going to melt your fuel.
So the same token, R is more heterogeneous than your crystal particle, so your feedback's pretty much non-existent.
Yeah, well, in a PWR rod, right, it's so close to its melting point.
Plus, it's more heterogeneous than your tricycle.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, they're operating so close to the melting temperature, you can't get it. So here's the fun part.
First, it's already at 1 hour, right? 20 minutes.
Let's look at the fun part.
Yeah.
Okay.
Try to get it down within 15 minutes.
All right, so the big point I want to make out of here is there's a huge difference in the heterogeneous versus homogeneous. The homogeneous has a very large power peaking, and then that, when it reaches a power, 60 times what the original power was, it finally creates enough heat that it has a huge response in negative reactivity. Whereas in our Doppler feedback, you can see, look, all the heat is being generated in the fuel kernel, so it's increasing the temperature of the fuel kernel quite a bit. And then as time goes on, a lot of that heat moves out into the matrix. This is also integrated energy, so you can see that there's a lot less energy created over a short time scale for the heterogeneous than the homogeneous. So another interesting thing is that a long time scale, once you get to about 10 seconds, they're, in terms of integrated power and temperature, or at least in terms of integrated power, they're pretty similar. So this is really cool graph, but got another maybe even cooler one for you here. This is approximately the temperature of the matrix, approximately the temperature of the fuel, and you'll see a very different response. This is the capture energy spectrum, and this is where Monte Carlo really gives me an edge because I can resolve each of these individual resonances. So I'll wait for it to start again. So this is at the beginning of simulation. There's no change in the capture amounts. But then as the temperature of the fuel comes up, look at all this Doppler. I can tell you exactly what resonances it's happening at. And it doesn't look like much is happening here. And then all of a sudden, as the heat escapes out of the matrix, as you get into longer time frames, look at the feedback right there. That's a thermal feedback. That was actually why I needed S alpha beta, was because without S alpha beta, this whole transient that happens in the later part of the simulation isn't captured. So I really think this is cool because it gives me an incredible amount of understanding of what's happening in the neutronics in the whole problem. That you have kind of a moderator response and a fuel response, and they cause very different things to happen to the capture cross sections. Another interesting thing is you have this this resonance right here that's probably playing a big role in why everything's shifting, but it's actually a fission resonance more than it is a capture resonance. So just to zoom in, you saw some of this. This is kind of the capture. This is between zero and a certain number of seconds. And again, I can resolve each of the individual resonances, and this is plotted with the homogeneous. And the homogeneous, as I was saying, it has higher peaks. It has more worse. So you can see that the homogeneous case has more absorption in the resonances because of the locality of the uranium and the fuel.
How much Doppler are you getting because of capture, and how much due to the fission resonance? Because if I think of a fast reactor and a thermal reactor, mostly you are at the low energies here at the resonances.
Well, I can answer, I'll answer that in the next slide.
Okay.
So, this is also just a log, so I have a log. So this would be negative down here, negative changes, this is positive changes. So you can actually see that you have these resonances and you can attribute them. You can tell now more of the individual smaller resonances, exactly which one is which. And there's some interesting things like, why is there a negative, you think, I've been talking about absorption, it increases absorption, so there's a lot of increase in absorption up here, but why is there even a negative component? That's because if we go back and we look at these actual Doppler wings, we can see that these are the really sharp, it's a little difficult to tell, but these are the really sharp resonances here. And in the center of the resonance, you actually get a decrease in capture, and that's pretty intuitive because your cross-section is actually decreasing in the center, but the edges around the resonance where it's broadening out more than makes up for this. So I can see very clearly what I was talking about earlier in the presentation.
This is just self-shielding.
Well,
it's like exactly like how you would see. So the inner part of your fuel gets less flux than the outer part. And when you average it out, it looks like the wings are enhanced of the resonances.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, which is what you see clearly on the big one on the bottom. The hard one, the other ones are overlapping. It's hard to see.
Yeah. What's interesting is that it's the upward greater captured part beats the less captured part. So statistically, as I was talking about before, these wings beat out these troughs for more capture, at least in U-238. Now to get to your fission question, what happens to the fission? You don't see a lot happening here. This is the fission energy spectrum for each one, so you don't see actually a lot happening on each of these. But let me do a log plot, and you can actually see that in these resonances for the fission resonances, you can see, oh look right there, look at that fission resonance. It's actually where you have these fission resonances, you get more. You get positive temperature feedback from these fission resonances. And I haven't been able to quantify exactly how much you get from one or the other, but it's very clear that you get some from both, and in the enrichment study, it makes a lot more sense. Delayed precursors, there's not a lot happening here. This is just kind of the miscellaneous other data. It may look like in the beginning that you're getting a laser pointer just ran out, that you're getting a spatial distribution of flux drop and also a fission drop, but this is actually 99.8. So you get a 0.2% flux drop in the center of the kernel, which means, you know, the mean free path of a neutron is much greater than the kernel size, right? So the neutrons are basically passing right through the kernel.
But that's average. So if you look at one resonance, it's more like the picture you saw before.
Exactly. Yeah. If I look at one resonance, it would be huge, a huge drop. But yeah, it's averaged over all of them. What I want to say is this really proves a lot of the work that I want to do in my thesis, because I believe with my simulation and with what I've gotten, I've clearly proven the prop temperature feedback is happening. I can tell you why it's happening, where it's happening, and then I can even, you know, as an added bonus, I got that S alpha beta effect that I actually found out that the later transient in the moderator has a fair effect in the fuel. So as far as I know, this is the first known example of a transient simulation using on-the-fly S-alpha-beta broadening. So this was Andrew Pablo's work with previous PhD students. So I'm using the last PhD student one of the last PhD students who graduated work to do my work. So I thought that was kind of novel and cool. So here's where I get into what I was talking about. I have all these parametric studies, and each of them is, some of them are a little longer than others, but they're all on par with the last one I showed you. And we can't go through them all, and already we're behind time. But I just want to make a point that I have all these, and maybe if we have a little bit, I'm going to rush to the end, but if we have a little bit more time, if you see any here that you'd really like to see in more detail, I can probably jump back to here towards the end, or we can talk more afterwards. So I'm going to jump to conclusions. Slide 132, if you're keeping track in the slides. So I just want to highlight, you know, there's several findings that I have from these studies. And one of them is there's an optimal thermal resistance that balances your fuel temperature, at your fuel temperature peaking and your thermal resistivity for the transient. There's also an optimal spectrum. In the spectrum study, I found out that an epithermal spectrum is the optimal spectrum for this feedback. If your spectrum's too fast, you don't go to the resonance, you don't get down to the resonance. If you're too thermal, you pass right through the resonances. Other ones, Doppler feedback is actually roughly proportional to U-238 percentage. So that was another interesting finding. I have an S-alpha-beta study that's very interesting, and I have a case when I was looking at the tungsten absorber of why I think UO2 on the out, like, so I'll show you in the improved case. So here's an improved fuel design that I'm suggesting, and one of the biggest changes is I went uranium nitride fuel kernel and depleted UO2 coating. So that gives you both an absorber and a low thermal conductivity as a coating, which beats out the zirconium. And as you can tell, the temperature profile is much better for the, I wouldn't say optimized design, but I'll say improved design. In terms of worth, this is really one of the testaments for how good just a first order attempt to improve it is. We went from $17.50 of negative worth to $34. We've doubled the amount of negative worth by tweaking some of these parameters, and we've also improved a lot of the transient responses. So there's, I can get into a little bit of detail on this, but I just want to say that for a lot of the reactivity insertions, they added linearly, but when you have this coating of UO2 on the outside because it's absorbing some of the neutrons in a certain resonance, it actually, they don't add linearly. You know, the red and the blue lines in the last, almost all the previous ones, they added linearly, but because the same resonances exist in both of these, they don't really quite add linearly. When I say moderated worth, that's also including the worth of the coating. So that's why you see there's actually more worth in this case in what I term the moderator, because there's more worth in the coating because all of the neutrons are getting absorbed. I'll show you this slide. Look at the spatial flux. Again, there's not a huge depression, but within the resonances, there, as we talked about, there would be. You can see in the improved case, you have this very interesting, where the coating is, where the UO2 is, you get a lot of absorptions, and then you actually have an increase in the flux in the center of the fuel pen, which I found very interesting. Just to show you, this one's not an animated one, this one's just showing the temperature of the kernel, temperature of everything, but the reference case that I've been comparing to, that was the heterogeneous case that I showed you before, compared to the optimized case, and you can see how much slower it's responding to the transient, and how much, you know, it's basically, especially in the beginning of the transient, it does quite a bit better. Because of its, you know, if you look at the relative, you know, the power peaking is much later and nowhere, it's a bit less. So I can get a lot more in depth into a lot of this stuff, but I think, again, our time's starting to run short.
It already ran.
Yeah. So, okay, well, we'll just go to conclusions. I feel a little bit lacking in my conclusion, mainly because this is a very computationally intensive problem. Every single one of my simulations that I considered to be high fidelity took 128 cores a week to perform. You know, this wasn't simple computationally. So I wish I could have done more Optima.
I should have stayed another year.
Well, I still wouldn't have time because there would be so many to do. I'd be here until, well, maybe if you factored in Moore's law into the equation and we got better. Maybe if you bought Dr. Xi a multi-million dollar cluster, you think?
But he doesn't want these students because you think you
bought. You need a cluster.
So, you know, I just want to say that I feel like when I was searching for a PhD topic, I really searched for something philosophical. What I felt was a new concept that wasn't well understood, something that was challenging, that I had to do a lot of cutting edge. You know, I had to build a supercomputer partly, and then I had to fix the supercomputer to get even half the simulations done that I've gotten done. I've had to do a whole bunch of things that aren't even related necessarily to my exact research, such as coding and software programming, to finally get the results that I needed. So there was a lot of, you know, a lot of work that I did. It was challenging. And then when I got it done, I believe I've shown, you know, this is a clear proof of the concept, and it's clearly more in depth than anything that has ever been done in literature, at least. And I've also studied the parameters involved in the response, and we had to skip over all the trade studies. I really do have a lot there. And I was able to show that I could modify the parameters to cause an improved response. So, you know, I submit to you that, you know, that I've done, completed the work that would be commensurate with a doctorate of philosophy. And just real quick, I did want to mention I have a lot of my publications out there. A lot of them are more space related. I have my journal preprint, which isn't yet. We're still working on journal stuff. Part of it was I had this idea that I could write my thesis chapters and submit those as journal articles. But then I found out I needed them to be like 10 pages or something. And it's been this whole mess of trying, like, when I submitted Dr. G, the original draft, he's like, this is way too long, I'm going to cut it down. So it's been some editing, and then I've been stuck on the presentation. But before I graduate, I expect, and I, you know, this is what I am going to do 100%. I'll be working on this through the summer to complete these three journal articles that cover what I'm talking about.
None was submitted yet. You're working on it.
Yeah, there's. I have the. If you want to make that a requirement of it, that's fine. Whatever.
Our requirement is to have the paper submitted.
Yeah.
The program.
Yeah. So. Okay. Well, I've submitted some papers, but I will definitely wrap up these. You already have the first one written, so you know. It, and the other one is really just cutting down one of my thesis chapters. So, and then that one, the first one, is really just a reiteration of one of the papers I wrote for Pfizer last year, because I wrote the original methodology for Pfizer.
So the ideal case is that your paper is accepted. That's another proof that what you did is novel enough, mm-hmm. and nobody had a comment that this was done by somebody else, and it's something new. That's the point of the paper.
Yeah. So with that, I'd really like to put it forth to the committee, who is, I guess my fate is in your hands, so I'd say. Or any last questions or comments or whatever.
Yes, I have one question. So in your improved design that you showed, I'm kind of thinking if you have a space reactor, mm-hmm. you probably want a highly enriched uranium there to maximize this, reduce the size of the core. How would you implement your methodology there? You have to mix something with the fuel.
So
is your methodology be sufficient for that? Like adding a uranium oxide on the layer there, or?
So in one of my studies, I can show that the feedback is proportional to enrichment. So the difference between, let's say, 5%, 10%, 20%, maybe even 40%, it's not huge. You can still get a lot of Doppler. But say going from 80 to 90, 90 to 95, those would be huge. Those would be just, it would be very difficult. So there'd be some threshold. If you have 50% enriched, you can get half as much worth as you, well, you know, more than half as much than if you were 10% enriched.
So what would you do? You like space reactors. What would you do there?
So what would I do? So there's also thermal resistance is another thing, that if you design the size of the particle. So the size of the particle can be any size. And even if you have a very, space reactors are traditionally low power density compared to terrestrial reactors. It's because you only need a megawatt or two. You don't really need gigawatts.
So you don't need to enrich. If it's not propulsion, you don't.
So there's a few, actually in this paper, I talk about, this one, I talk about some of the laws of reactor scaling, and I have several of them plotted on there, and just saying, in the beginning, when you design a small reactor, your criticality limit, so you want high enrichment when your criticality limit. And that generally happens up until you get into maybe tens of megawatts. And when you're above tens of megawatts, now you're thermally limited. So your enrichment doesn't matter as much. It's the surface area of your core to do heat removal that matters. So there is a regime if you have if you want a very small space reactor, you want as high of enrichment as you can get. Most of the ones that I've studied, for example, the senior design this year is doing a 20 megawatt thermal core for Europa, and that one, you can do with 20% enrichment pretty well. But if you were doing maybe a 100 kilowatt design, when you look at specific mass, and you look at power per unit mass, then you want to get as high enriched as you possibly can. Because even if you use americium 241N,
right?
You know that.
I know that.
You can make a little, you know.
That's attractive because you launch nothing. The way to launch this to space is minimized when you enrich or do something like that.
Yeah. So I do have, that was almost my PhD thesis, was looking at the laws of reactor scaling. But I chose to do this one.
Okay, so there is a challenge if you need a compact core, how to utilize this mechanism.
Yeah. And a compact core, there's one that's being made right now called Kilopower. They actually just poured the core and they're going to do some tests in November on it. It's molybdenum, uranium alloy, and it expands. The thermal expansion on it is more than enough to give you your prompt temperature feedback. And then just because when you're so small, you're more sensitive to leakage, so generally smaller cores can do a pretty good job of doing the kind of thermal spectrum shifting to cause more neutrons to leak out of the core.
And you didn't answer my other question, was that you showed the curve where you compare yourself with the other code, and there was a certain time to peak and a certain peak temperature. And what is the physics that determines that?
So a lot of that has to do with your thermal resistance and your reactivity insertion amount. So I've got, let me see if I can pull up.
So I see the magnitude is a function of the inserted reactivity, but is the peaking time as well?
So the peaking time is, that one should be find one somewhere around here. Okay, this is measured in prompt neutron lifetimes. So that one's a little bit weird. This is maybe one of the ones.
No, it was the one you compared with, I don't know what study it is.
Yeah.
Compared with, what's his name?
Here we go. Thermal barrier. So what I'm trying to show you is one of my trade studies that looked at that aspect of.
Okay.
For example, here you can see kind of a few different peaks. You can see that. There's different thermal barrier coating thicknesses. The thicker it is, the more thermal resistance you have. So what you get is with more thermal resistance, you get a faster drop. And that's what we think. The more thermal resistance you have, the faster the decrease in your activity, the faster you peak. So your thermal resistance, more thermal resistance you have, the faster you're going to peak in your spectrum. And then there's another study that I also looked at that was on how much, if you insert $1 of reactivity or $2 of reactivity, or you know, those also have a huge effect on where your peak is. And there's a whole lot of second order effects that can come into play, but I really think it comes down to the more thermal resistance, up to a point. If you have too much thermal resistance, like in some of the Wirth curves, let's try to find one.
How about the size of the...
The size of the reactivity.
What the size of the kernel?
Yeah, the size of the kernels, it gets bigger, there's more thermal reactivity, or there's more thermal resistance. So it'll actually peak faster.
And then faster?
Now there's a little bit of a caveat on there because if you keep the same power density in your fuel kernel, that's fine, but if you keep the same power density in your unit volume area, then it kind of changes a few things. So it's a little bit complex because if you make your kernel bigger, do you also say that you are creating more power because you want to keep the power the same?
So in validation, everything was of the order of half a second. Here, you're much, much faster.
That was because I used his profile. I didn't use his neutronics model at all. He had a power profile in his paper. So I just took his power profile and fed it into my thermal model. So. Because his pebble bed reactor was very, very thermal, it had a much longer I should also mention prompt neutron lifetime is another big factor in that. That if you have a shorter, in the spectrum study, you'll see that in the fast core, it peaks incredibly fast. Whereas in the thermal core, it takes a very long time, almost like 100 times longer to peak.
Now the dead mode resistance is compatible for this part.
So he had this gas gap on there, and that gas gap increased the thermal resistance quite a bit, but he was also dealing with a much lower power density. So his power density was 10 megawatts per meter cubed, or minus 200. So I'm doing 200 times the power density, but my thermal resistance is probably 1/10 of his.
Look at shifting cars.
Yeah.
So if that's the case, the TRISO particles and gas reactors have been around for the last 15 to 16 years. Mm-hmm. What is it that is lacking in those TRISOs? What is it you have in the physical dimension? In other words, is it I make a different particle? Is it feasible to make it?
So
is it just a computational thing?
The idea of putting a coating to increase thermal resistance is completely counter to the tradition.
Right.
Everybody's like, we want high thermal resistance everywhere, or high thermal conductivity everywhere. And I'm saying, no, you want a very thin layer of very low resistance.
It's one more layer you need
yeah.
in the design is not totally unthinkable. That's what you're saying.
Yeah.
So from a materials perspective, there's no problem to code it.
Right.
So you can code it as a transfer particle. The only thing is to code it differently. Some of that you are coding is materials.
It's challenging in nano manufacturing.
Well,
nanosecond calculation.
Yeah, but you will also run this probably close to the melting temperature,
yeah.
so your margin is small.
It depends. A lot of the HTGRs, they ran a very low power density because they wanted passive heat removal. And the only way they could achieve that was a low power density. So it really depends on your design and your operational power, and also your size of your particle. And again, maybe you go with, instead of uranium nitride, say uranium oxide, you go with uranium nitride with the coating. So what I'll argue is that you have a lot of material options to play with the size, with, you know, that's kind of what I explored in my trade studies. One of the trade studies was specifically on particle size. So you can tune that thermal resistance to almost any core power that you want. So if you have a very, very high power core, you're going to have very, very small particles. If you have a very low power core, you're going to have very large particles. Or maybe your coatings are what you get into.
But the same token, if you have a dilute dispersion, like only 20% transfer particle, it behaves radically different from 80% transfer.
In terms of spectrum, or in terms of?
In terms of the transient response, because just imagine your annular rings,
mm-hmm.
and I barely have any trisotopes in them.
Yeah.
So in a dilute dispersion,
mm-hmm.
so that behaves differently.
I have one study on fuel vol. Well, it's the spectrum study, and what I did.
It's the density of the particles in the water.
The density of the particle. Yeah. So. In one of my studies, what I did is I changed the fuel to moderator ratio, basically. So I basically changed the pitch
yeah.
of the particles. And I can show you, I have a lot of results on that one too. So if we had a lot more time, I'd be able to just see the spectrum. Here we are, here's the spectrum one. There's my epithermal, the green one. This was the one with the most feedback. Look at that resonance right there. It just eats away at the spectrum. So in these I have a different packing, basically, of particles. The particles are all the same size, but I have a different packing. So here's how that changes. In this one I elected to keep the total power the same, not the power density. So you can kind of, you can see here too the peaks for the faster ones. They peak a lot faster. So it almost looks like, oh, look how fast the reactivity decreases for the high fuel percentage. But one of the things you have to look at too, as I was mentioning, prompt neutron lifetimes. Look at the order, two order magnitude difference in prompt neutron lifetimes between these, which. This is an interesting one because instead of being plotted in time, it's plotted in prompt neutron lifetime. So every curve is shifted. And now you see that it's the highest fuel percentage that comes down last. I'd love to go through all these and just.
So you really got a new concept for accident tolerant fuels.
I'll say that it's very flexible. What needs to happen is someone needs to go through and maybe do some of the, maybe Rao can do some of the more experiments.
So Chris, let me ask you. So in terms of innovation, the key concept behind that is that you have this coating, right?
Mm-hmm.
Someone very coating with a low conductivity,
mm-hmm.
and then you have a maximum temperature confined, get a maximum feedback. So for this coating, so I'm just wondering, somehow you mentioned to me it doesn't matter, coating, right?
Oh, for the
so you
neutrons.
Have a high thermal conductive coating or a low thermal conductive coating, it really doesn't matter. You're talking about this principle, the feedback principle. And then so I'm thinking about if you coat in zirconium or you coat in tungsten, highly thermal conductive materials, If you coat it zirconium, that's equivalent to you just increase the UO2 size. If you coat it tungsten, you just increase the, reduce the particle size or just increase. You can consider tungsten as particle matrix. Right? So the basic concept, obviously, it doesn't relate to coating. It's the only thing is, you have this positive feedback or negative feedback, but not we ever explore that before. You can base upon the doublets, boarding, and then control the activity. It's not related to the coating concept at all. Right? So whatever coating you apply doesn't affect your heat transfer too much anyway. Right? If you coat in zirconium, zirconium thermal conductivity is almost comparable to UO2. Not much difference. Right?
It's not the thermal conductivity, the thermal diffusivity of the coating which does all this. Okay, that gives me the time constant.
Some of the facility.
That dictates the time behavior. It's not just the thermal conductivity.
Yeah, same thing, right? Yeah. Some of the facility is always similar with UO2.
So it then the coating is okay in terms of normal steady state temperature, doesn't change, right?
The goal would be to have a infinitely low thermal conductivity, but an infinitely thin area. That would be the ideal. You do want your when you talk about uranium oxide. Now, one of the things I did model was gas gaps. So maybe instead of a coating, something that seems to be even better than a coating is what if you fill the region with kind of a gas gap void type area for fission product gases, and maybe instead of a coating, it's just a space, right? So the fundamental idea is not necessarily coatings, but it's more of just a thermal resistance matching, and you want it to be over just a small area between the fissile fuel kernel and whatever your moderator matrix is. So you want that area to have very low thermal conductivity. And in my final study, one of the reasons I picked zirconium oxide does have a lower thermal conductivity than uranium oxide in a lot of respects. But the thing about the uranium oxide is it also has Doppler as well. But I had to make the coating pretty.
So the uranium, the decay UO2 will be the best coating if you want to apply this coating technology, right?
I mentioned that there's a little bit of complexity in there because if I showed you my tungsten trade, the tungsten didn't come out as good as I expected it to, but it was only 15 micrometers thick, whereas the coating for uranium oxide was 125 micrometers thick. So you might, if you're really concerned about the thickness of the coating, maybe you just say, well, tungsten only needs to be, because it's such a strong, so much of a stronger absorber, you don't need, you can't have much of it or else it'll destroy your criticality capability in your core. So it's actually a very complex, I wish I could give you a single answer, but what I can say is that uranium oxide is the most promising in terms of giving me the most worth. There might be, in terms of its resonance structure, in terms of a lot of things, but you might have other considerations like thickness, size, there's a lot of design criteria that goes into more of a, I have a reactor design and this is what it is, whereas I'm trying to explore kind of the more fundamental aspects of it.
Yeah, that's okay. I mean, the only concern is, if you look at the community, as you said, this concept is, contradict with common wisdom.
Yeah.
And then whenever you want to package your idea, you have to make people believe that. Now, I feel like it's more easier to say, we look at this Doppler broadening effect instead of this coating concept. Mm-hmm. And if it's a coating concept, people may not believe you. Because it's just different with what we saw in general. But if you look at this point, this Doppler feedback, I think that's new, innovative, and in the whole community, it'll be much easier to accept the concept. Right? And now it's regardless of coding, for example, we talk about UTP, UO2 are the best one. So in that case, we have already have a zoning concept in terms of defined fuel. In that case, what you have here, at the surface, you maybe only have UO2, deeply UO2, you don't have much enrichment, but inner side, you have high enrichment. Right? So in that case, it's not coding at all, it's just when you do the field fabrications, you have these zones. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It'd be, it's something where there's a lot of potential solutions to the problem, but if you look at it fundamentally, you would say this is something that's really good. So I might have found a local maxima, right? I found this. There might be some other coding combination, but that makes the spectrum a little bit better. But I've identified the effect. I've shown that it's there, and I can say if you put this in your reactor core right now, it will have an improvement. So
I think it's right. It's a lot more easier for people to digest if you say engineering for a Doppler feedback. Perception down. That's what you're doing. That's
engineering. So
you're doing the same thing. But okay. The moment you say I want to engineer the particle, and it gives me Doppler.
So since the phenomena, the truth is always there.
Yep.
But nobody explored that before, including in your literature based validation. They also have the solar temperature profile, but probably they haven't looked at this Doppler body effect in terms of reactivity control.
Yeah.
This is something new that you want to practice.
So maybe I should change my thesis title.
I think it is more in the summary. That's what you're trying to say.
Yeah.
What do I get out of it? That's what people will read in the abstract and stuff.
Yeah.
That's good. So look at all the publications you're preparing. So we'll make it sound like a you're doing field material work. It pass those to the material. If the material people review this work, they wouldn't appreciate it because they don't understand it's Doppler feedback. They only look at the material side. They don't do anything about the material side. So just make the name.
Engineering, improving safety by engineering Doppler. Fundamentally, that's what
we're
doing.
And then help people to do it, and then you can apply different coding.
Well, we can do it in the world.
The one comment I had that you mentioned that having a gap there, that would not be very good for a steady state operation because you always operate with a high peaking in your kernel inside. If you increase the resistivity, I think your steady state would be.
You make it smaller in that case, maybe.
You have to make sure that in steady state you don't keep a gradient in the fuel that you don't want. You want to flatten it in steady state. But so if you add uranium, like you suggested, that adds the more of the Doppler stuff.
Dr. Shimpada actually mentioned a while back, he says, oh, you want to make a fuel that behaves like a metal during steady state, but a ceramic during transient.
Exactly. Yes. So, yeah.
Any more questions?
Yep. Sorry. I'll be here. The audience can ask me questions.
I don't have any questions from the audience.
From Power Broker?
I did such a great job explaining.
Chris here, who asked if you have more questions on this?
No, I don't know.
Okay, so.